There we go. Here we go.
Gonna.
Amazing. Okay. So, welcome everybody to She's of Love. This week we are with the beautiful Renee, who is a trained therapist. And do you call yourself a therapist or a counselor? What was it that you say again?
Actually, technically, I'm a therapeutic coach because I'm both a coach and a counselor. So I can kind of straddle both of those fences. So thanks for asking. Yeah.
Yeah, okay, that's amazing. So, yes, we've got Renee joining the show, and as she just said, therapist, therapeutic coach.
Yeah, that sounds
That
great.
sounds very cool. So for today's topic, we're talking about putting ourselves first. And I guess when I was really feeling into this topic today, I feel like you're such a good person to talk about this because I imagine that you have a lot of professional experience with this topic and then also personal experience, of course. So I guess I'll just hand the mic over to you and you can just start wherever you want from like whatever you want to go with this. I give you the baton.
Thank you, Juliet. Thanks, Claudia.
She's put you on the spot now.
Well, oh gosh, this is such a big topic area because I feel like I need to separate it out into different topics even. So if you talk about putting yourself first, the first thing that comes to mind for the older generations is selfishness and narcissism.
Yes, those
So,
labels are huge.
yeah. And so then that topic has to be discussed then today, which is really interesting. But the younger generation knows about putting themselves first. But what if they take it to an extreme, where it's ungrounded and unbalanced? So there's the place of balance around putting yourself first. And I think that's what I want to talk to today because that is the key. And it's like because of the last few years in particular, everything's gone off balance. And you guys and I have both talked about even families off balance, completely off balance. I can put my hand up for that too. Like I'm
Yeah, me
not
too.
perfect. Not perfect when it comes to all of that, because we can't control anyone else. The only person we can control is ourselves. And that is, it's almost like every time I step into that kind of area, every time I get almost get a whiplash back from the universe saying, oh, I can't manage that or control that. Ooh. So this is what putting yourself first is all about, is actually managing your own shit. Like, so, and not blaming other people.
Yeah, that's the thing. Because that's being a victim, right? That's when you and you're giving your
Yes.
power away as well. When you blame
Yes.
others and
Yes.
you stay in that mindset of not taking
Yeah.
responsibility,
Yeah.
it can become even more toxic because
Yes.
then
Yes.
not only are you, which in our society, it's encouraged. I feel like it's encouraged,
Yes.
particularly with young people,
Yes.
to label their
Problems.
yeah, their issues like, oh, I'm the victim of narcissism, or I'm a victim of abuse, or I'm a victim of this and that. And that's not to take away from people who have been
Absolutely.
abused. And
Absolutely.
yeah, it's not taking away from that. This is something else that we're talking about here. This is victim mentality. It's
Yes. Yes.
taking it's being selfish in a toxic way
Yes.
that is
Yes.
not giving yourself your own power. It's giving your power away when you stay in the victim.
Exactly. So if I can put it also another way and take that to another level too, because this is what I work with people on all the time and on myself too. So we're all a work in progress. So I'm just putting that up, my hand up for that too. And certainly 2023 reminded me I'm really a work in progress. And there's different years that have it's been a major theme in my life. But the other important component, and I was even talking to someone the other day down at the beach, and I was starting to tell my story about a few things. Very personal, so I won't get into that here, but trying to tell my story, but she took it to a different place. And when I was starting to say, no, she was taking it to her own place. So this is another part of the problem with even talking to friends sometimes, even talking to, and this is why a therapist is so important and imperative, is because they remain neutral and are merely a sounding board. And I was talking to my husband last night about what a good therapist is. Listening. Number one. The therapist even taking accountability in their, even if they don't have a perfect life, you don't want them to have a perfect life, so then they'll understand your imperfect life.
Yes, I was gonna say.
If you're going to the perfect therapist, think again. So isn't that interesting? Acknowledge imperfections. Understanding, respect, empathy, guidance, all those kinds of things. We also have to go to someone who's grounded in reality too. And so if you're going to put yourself first, therapy might be the first step. And that's kind of why I wanted to mention that. Yeah. Back to the topic, you know, so that might be the thing. But if it's not, if your therapist just says, oh, yeah, you're the victim of a narcissist before you even get to tell your story, they might be incorrect too, which is a bit scary. So there's all these terms being bandied about, and there's an element of truth in some of them. In fact, every single person, I like what the holistic psychologist says about this, every single person on the face of the planet has elements of narcissism within them.
Of course we do. Of
It's
course we do.
human. Our ego, I feel like our ego is so good at any ego is a narcissist. Any ego
Yeah,
is a narcissist.
this nature of the ego is to be a narcissist.
Everything is about me. I'm like, this is the ego
It's not
talking.
my fault. I couldn't help it. All
They
of that.
I hate that them. They're the cause of all my problems.
And looking outward.
Literally anything that your ego says is narcissistic, because the ego is designed, I mean,
By
by
nature
nature, the to protect us and to, you know, to
and
keep
by
us safe.
evolution.
And, you know, I think the ego has a huge role in this society, because we wouldn't be where we are. I really don't believe we would be where we are with all the technology and the trains and the planes and the houses with our ego. I think we would just be like a lot of other animals out there. But at the end of the day, the ego is a survival, like it's meant for survival, and we now no longer live in a world where that's necessary every day, at
But
least for most people. I know sometimes it is, but
there's a sliding scale, isn't there? Right? So everything in this world has two sides. It has the polarity. You know, we have the ego, which is slightly narcissistic, but
Not slightly, it is
you know,
very narcissistic.
well, it by nature it's narcissistic. And you know, do you just listen to the ego and you know, just appease its every whim and live your life that way, just dedicated to your ego and you know, Because it, and I think narcissists have been traumatized, obviously, when they're very young. So, you know, that has skewed something in them that they feel they need to protect that side of themselves. So they just continually act from this survival part of themselves. You know, that's what a narcissist is they believe that they're going to die if they don't get what they set out to do, or their brain believes that because of trauma that's happened to them, their bl brain believes that they're right.
To the point of manipulating people out, like
And
feeling the need.
doing really, really bad stuff.
Yeah, just
Yes. Yes. Yes.
Yeah. And
Yes,
meddling
to
in
all of
people's
that.
lives and all of that that goes with it.
Yes. Yeah. So, and oh, this is interesting because, I could go down another rabbit hole and I won't for the purpose of this audience around personal stuff because I can talk to all of that. But
Yeah.
there's also the flip side of actually why putting yourself first is important in a
Yeah.
healthy way.
Yes.
Because then you start to go, okay, what's my part in this? And then what do I need to cut off? What do I need
Yes.
to take a break from?
Yep.
What do I like? So, and this is what's interesting in so, yeah. So in the original training I did, it was absolutely amazing. It was actually how to lose your ego and
Yeah,
still
right.
help others. And yet social media does the opposite, right?
Yeah.
So I have been accused of narcissism almost continuously since I put myself on social media from my own profession.
Yeah,
And
right.
I was one of the first in Australia to run online therapy courses. There's all that kind of stuff like that potentially, like I have had such backlash, but because I'd had the training that I had, it's like, no, this is important for others so they get a handle of their own egos. So they get
Yeah.
a handle of this narcissistic place that is social media. So they get a, like, I am actually coming from that place, but people don't seem to understand. Okay, so there's this necessary evil that is social media and it's necessary in business. How am I going to do it in such a way that is humble and grounded, but also connects to the right kind of people? And I guess I keep bringing it back to people like Brené Brown and the holistic psychologist, because I feel like they've got a really good balance of that,
Yeah.
and that's, I almost look to people like that on how to manage my brand and manage my stuff and all that kind of stuff, like
Yeah.
so that then it doesn't go too much into narcissism, but so that I'm always like, in terms of you guys too, connecting with other people to go, like, are we thinking right about this? Are we like, where,
Yeah.
like what do we need to check in about? Because I was brought up in my profession, being a reflective practitioner and a reflective person. So
Right.
even if things are shit, or you might have, I mean, I'm just talking to the audience, you might have a narcissistic family member, or you might have a sociopathic family member, or you might have, someone with all sorts of learning difficulties, or someone with, autism, or someone with all these neurodiversity kind of things that are all coming through, or, issues on the LGBTI, like we've, like in my family, I've got a massive extended family. There's all sorts of things. But I know everybody's experiencing these kinds of things, like on a whole other level. It's happening across families because I see families, I see couples, individuals. Like this stuff is happening with almost every single person I see. It's why I feel like I can speak to the kind of multi-layers of, just in terms of the general gist of things.
Yeah.
So the general gist of things is that we aren't in Kansas anymore, Toto. That's my take. Yeah.
Yeah.
And so if we aren't in Kansas anymore, Toto, then what does that mean for our, overall our families, workplaces? Like what? Where are we at? I mean, COVID, the great leveler and the great messed up shit And was that by design? I think we could talk about all that to you know, like, so, but what if, and some people in these spiritual, new age spiritual communities are talking about the, what if this has actually been to strip us off our ego and go, come back home?
I feel like this, I feel like the last few years have kind of like put a crack in society. It kind of like really, really created a crack and shook everything up. And then all the pieces landed all in different places to what it was before. And like we've talked about previously together, families broke up, friendships broke up, marriages broke up, even parents and children, you know, like it affected those relationships as well. And I think now what's happening is the fallout has happened, and now people are starting to make choices for themselves, which is what we're talking about today. Because I don't believe everybody is choosing out of love for themselves,
No.
which is why this is
But
so
I think
important, this topic.
to add to that though, something that I view in my own generation is that with this COVID and everything that's happened over the past few years, every year has been crazier than the last. And even though 2020 was definitely the most shocking out of all, like we just, as humanity, we haven't caught a break since then. And I think, I know speaking from my own experience, my generation is coming into adulthood and already starting out in adulthood is like such a scary time. But to come out into adulthood, out from the your parents' or guardians' home to that sheltered reality, out into the world, into this crazy place, which is a lot more crazier at the moment. And I think also there's a really big negativity going around about it as well. Like, this world sucks. I don't ever want kids
Yeah, there's
because
a
this
real,
world sucks. And
there's a real victim mentality, I think, that was
yes.
born.
But I think I think that it's, I agree 100%. And I think that it's,
Encouraged.
I think that's why my generation is struggling a bit right now because we're trying to figure out this new world. Being an adult and by navigating it on our own. And now it's so hard. Like, luckily, I have the insight to recognize that this world isn't actually all that crazy when you don't watch the news and when you don't pay
You
attention
don't
to
expose
the
yourself to
story.
it. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, when I, because I've got the mindset that the world is actually really beautiful, and even though there's some crazy stuff going on right now, that's not really the big picture, even though it's trying to make it seem like that is the big picture. The big picture is literally as far away from the news and what the news says. I'm like, yeah, I'm thinking more about travel and people, like the beauty of people and the beauty of nature and getting out of the city, and that's my perspective. And even with that perspective, being 20 has been the hardest year of my life so far because I'm navigating adulthood in this new world. Because in the past, since 2020, in the past 3, 4 years, the world has shifted
Massive
hugely.
shifts.
There's been huge shifts. And I think that's why, in my generation, like, you see some crazy stuff with us, like
Do you
the
think they're
mind.
overwhelmed, Juliet?
Yeah, I just, well, I just think that our generation, like that my generation is a little bit confused and trying to figure out this world because we're told
Yeah,
by
what's true
everyone,
and what's not?
well, no, I don't think it's a, I think yes, but as a group,
As a
I'm, as
collective.
a collective, I think a lot of us are just trying to navigate life, with everything that's being told by us. I mean, I still see us as children. I still see us as, and Gen Z is a lot of us are still kids. But when adults are diagnosing us with. I mean, I went to the doctors last year and I answered five questions, and then I was technically eligible to get this like discount with a psychotherapist because with a psychologist because I technically had anxiety, and that was after answering five questions in a doctor's office. And
I know, it's not enough.
yeah, it's and words like anxiety and depression and ADHD and all these like neurological disorders, although I hate seeing them that way, are thrown out so easily to us kids. And when we feel like we don't belong, it's like, oh, it's not because of trauma or whatever. No, it's because I have a mental disability, because that's what's pushed on us so much.
Yeah, so
And
true. That's so true,
it's,
Juliet.
yeah, it, and we're not taught to go inside. We're not taught, oh, I don't feel like I belong. Maybe I should journal about this or deal with this in another way. No, it means I have something wrong with my brain. And that's
Yep.
literally,
And now you're a victim.
and yeah, and but I don't blame my generation, although it is very frustrating sometimes to try and talk with people my age and hear the victimhood, but I don't blame my generation because we're just children for the most part. It's not our fault. But I think that's a big part of putting ourselves first in 2024 is rising above that, because it, as much
Yes,
as,
and taking your power back.
yeah, because as much as there
Yep.
is the mental health issue side and the victimhood side of my generation, there's a lot of awakening in my generation, I think, more so than any other generation in the past, however many decades and hundreds, centuries. Like,
100%.
can I ask you a question about that? Do you think that the young people who are receiving these labels, do you think that they're just accepting the label and becoming that label? Or do you think that they're saying, hang on a minute, you're putting that on me. I'm not going to accept it. I think it depends on the
Is
person.
that from me or from Juliet, the question? Or
Sorry.
both of you? Both of you.
Okay. Because I've got a technical professional opinion on that one too. So
Yeah,
that's a,
please.
there's a, this. So this is kind of where it gets really interesting. Okay. So the way I was trained was anti everything establishment.
Yeah, right.
So young people, particularly young women, need to look at feminist theory, not feminism, but
Right.
feminist therapy theory.
Okay.
Okay, so it, like Juliet, if you tell any of your girlfriends anything, feminist therapy theory,
Is there books on
because
this, or is it okay?
but it might be hard to find them, but so do not go with the woke version of what feminism is. Sorry, everyone, if you believe in current modern day feminism, it's gone off track.
Yeah,
We've
right.
got a train wreck coming at us with feminism right now.
Yep.
Okay. They've taken it to a whole other level, but the feminist therapy theory is on the mark. Okay. Because did your listeners know that 66 to 75% of all personality disorders are women?
Right.
Think about that. Think about that. Did your listeners know that Freud, who's the godfather of psychology and counseling and psychotherapy, did your listeners know that he just labeled a lot of women hysterical?
Yeah, that I did know
Oh
that.
my
I
God.
did know that.
Oh my God. That makes so much sense.
So history is doomed to repeat itself unless we learn the lessons of the past. We need to, as women, pull this rubbish out.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But okay, can I talk to something that you just said? Because something just came to me, a really big solution. So I've never experienced a man calling me hysterical, but I'm not surprised by any in the slightest with what you just said. But looking at my own life, when there has been times of victimhood or darker times, I've always seeked other women to help me get through it. I've never gone.
Because you haven't trusted that.
Yeah, I've never gone to a guy and been like,
But how
can you help me?
but how can you go, really, at the end of the day, think about it, how your instinct is correct, because how do you go, if I'm having problems that I feel only a woman would understand, I'm going to
That
go,
caused by my femininity.
yes, I'm going to go and seek women to talk to. I'm not going to go and seek a male opinion about that. So your instinct is correct in that way, is that if you're having an issue with something that's, with your femininity or with your feminine mind, it just makes sense to go and talk to your girlfriends and go and talk to people who you feel would understand that.
Yeah, because when you said that, Renee, about Freud, is that his name?
Godfather, yeah.
Yeah, I was not surprised by it any in the slightest. It makes so much sense. I never would have thought to think that, but now that you say it, it's like that makes
Well,
so many things clear.
and you think about it, there were no female therapists or psychologists back then, really. There weren't,
In the early
because they
days.
weren't encouraged to go into that. I mean, in those times,
Absolutely. But
men
if I can go
were,
somewhere else with that, this is where it gets
yeah.
really interesting and woo, it goes into witch bitch territory,
Yeah,
from the
right.
past, right? Is the women in the past, hundreds of years ago, and even 100 years ago, who were helping other women were still known as a bit like the wild witches or the wicked witches of the
Yes.
West and all this other kind of stuff. And there has been, and I've been just in the last year, I've been chewed up and spat out by men. Honestly, one of them called me superstitious, and I'm like, no,
Yeah.
nobody
You
calls
are,
me
yeah. I wonder if
superstitious.
they'd call a man, if you were a man, I wonder if they'd say you were superstitious. It's so interesting how these labels, and they're ancient labels, just keep coming back. They just keep coming back. And it's like when you can't tear someone down with a
It's like,
logical,
oh,
you start getting personal.
gotta pull out
You
the.
know that they've lost the argument. You know that a person has lost the argument when they start attacking you and your personality. Like, saying that you're superstitious, that's a personal attack on you. That's not a label that, anybody can just diagnose, if you know what I mean. It's a slanderous thing to say to somebody.
Exactly, which is why old wives' tales are real. It's why fairy tales need to be told,
Yeah, right.
but it's also why fairy tales about women need to be told.
Yeah,
Yeah.
which in its own little topic have also been fairy tales have also been hugely changed and overly
Manipulated.
manipulated and translated to by men to mean so many different things.
Brothers Grimm, yeah. Yeah, there's yeah, all the long the and then usually like the Hansel and Gretel story, the old woman is like a witch, and there's always the witch who, puts out seeds or that kind of thing, and but what if they aren't hurting children? What if they're trying to help the children in those kind of stories?
Yeah.
And what if it's the other side trying to flip it in their favor?
Yeah, and it also begs the question, why are they doing that? Why are they taking that power and twisting it around into something negative? It's because it's so powerful and it works. If it wasn't powerful and it didn't work and it wasn't something effective in the world, they wouldn't care. They wouldn't put their energy towards it. They wouldn't twist it around. It wouldn't be
Exactly.
something that was created to be bad. So that's like for me, when I'm doing research or when I'm hearing a story or if I'm listening to somebody talk about something, I usually ask myself the question, why is that particular thing being targeted? Why is that particular thing being twisted? Why is that thing getting that manipulation happening over there? And it's usually because, in my experience, it's usually because it's important. It has power of some kind that they're trying to take away. Yeah. And you know, men do it.
Exactly.
Men do it to women, and they sometimes it's unconscious that they're doing it. You know, like that person saying to you that you're superstitious. You know, it's he probably isn't like scheming and going, oh, I'll take her power away by telling her she's superstitious. Do you know what I mean? It's not like it's a thought process in that regard. It's more like we know that when we call a woman superstitious, it's going to bring her into disrepute. And when you
Yes,
don't have anything
that's what it
else,
is.
yes, when we don't have anything else to say, we don't have
The
another.
trusty dusty shame women card.
Yes, we revert to that, you know, old way of discrediting somebody. And that's the way you discredit a woman is to tell her she's being irrational, hysterical, superstitious, you're a witch, you know, you're turning it into something from science into something that's hocus pocus, you know, that kind of thing.
Yep, absolutely. Definitely. Definitely. There's so much that could be said on that topic alone. So probably for another day, because if we bring it back to this topic, because I guess this is where it gets important, particularly if we're talking to a women's audience, and I'm hoping, this is no sexism, because actually what they say in feminist therapy theory, and this is why there's a feminist therapy theory around, and why a lot of domestic violence services focus on women, not men. It's not about them being sexist. It's about protecting the mother, from men's influence. Protecting the mother and her sons so that they don't become abusers. It's about protecting the mother and her daughters. It's about protecting the future generations.
Yeah, I love that.
100% agree. Well, I guess I wanted to kind of talk more about some specific steps or some specifics around putting yourself first in the kind of that process of what that's like, whether fighting the ego or like any advice that you have when it comes to putting yourself first, because I think
Choices make that you're making.
because I think everyone kind of will agree that when you've not put yourself first for a while and then you finally do, it's not just
It
an
upsets the apple
easy,
cart. That's what it does.
and also it's just not, it's not as easy as I don't know, that I feel like you're
It's not
fighting a
easy.
stronger ego and
Well, you're also fighting against the current because women, we're raised. I didn't raise you this way, Juliet, but women, particularly in my generation, were raised as selfless beings. Is that you, particularly the mother figure, is, you know, she was selfless. She was to give to her children. She was there for her husband. She was, you know, that old-fashioned, even though I grew up in a progressive, I went to a progressive school. I still had the influence of my mother and my generations of women in my family. And particularly my grandmother, she was a very, very selfless woman. She was always in the background cooking. That was her job. She was always in the background, and she was Italian, so, and she couldn't speak English. So our communication was very feeling. It was a very feeling exchange. It wasn't a verbal exchange. It was all about how she treated me, how the vibe was in the house when I got there, because there was no language. So she was a very, very selfless woman, my grandmother. And she was a very downtrodden and beaten woman too, because my grandfather used to beat her. Yeah, it was it they had that old-fashioned relationship where nobody ever talked about it. Everybody knew, everyone knew about it, but nobody talked about it because my grandfather was a scary, scary man, and you never wanted to cross him. And I saw my dad cross him a few times because they didn't get along, because he was always defending his mother, because he was the eldest of three boys. He saw what was going on. So for me, growing up, this selfless woman, the Mother Mary figure in his life, in my father's life, which she was on a pedestal for him. And so that was my first real deep understanding of what a woman was. And then with my mom, my mother was a very vocal woman. She was very harsh, austere figure in my life, but she worked really hard. She didn't have hobbies. She didn't do anything for herself. Everything was around the family and working for money, and everything was about work with my parents. And so I didn't, doing things for myself was considered really extra and really kind of selfish in a way. And so for me, growing up and learning about all this stuff that we're talking about here was so out of left field for me. But I've grown to understand how important it is for the female psyche to get in touch with that side of ourselves and to nurture it. Because if we aren't putting boundaries down for ourselves, if we aren't growing that and nurturing that thing inside us that has wants and needs and desires and all of that stuff, we become a shell. And we're not teaching our children how to do it for themselves. We're teaching our sons that's how you treat a woman. She's second. She's not first. She's not important. We're teaching our girls that she puts herself last in situations. And I didn't want that for my kids.
And I have to almost agree wholeheartedly with you with all of those kind of things. And I
Yeah.
had si similar grandmothers, but same but different. But it was my mother's mother who was more like what you explained your father's
Right.
mother to be like, and my father's mother was a mother of eight who was very selfless. But this is
Well, with
tricky to
eight
say.
children.
But this is tricky to say out loud. Was accused of being a narcissist.
Right.
And so there's a whole range of other things there around the feminist therapy theory that could go there,
Yeah, right.
where there are stories that haven't been told about her.
Yeah, right.
And so there's themes in my family of not respecting women on both sides.
Yeah, and probably really toxic too, like things that were normal, considered to be normal behaviors, but now we see how toxic those things can have, because we've got the benefit of hindsight and all those years and the effects of those types of behaviors and how it's affected the generations to come.
Absolutely. So I wanted to just go back to something Juliet was talking about before,
Yeah,
though, because I
please
think it's
do.
relevant to even what you were saying there. So the intergenerational trauma component is heightened in young people if they're not aware or their family hasn't talked about intergenerational trauma.
Yeah,
It
right.
comes down anyway. Epigenetics has proven this. And over the years, I've tried to talk to my daughters in particular about this kind of stuff. But I feel like that's fallen on deaf ears, and it's then led to other things that shouldn't have happened. But this is the weird thing, is that if there's not a respect of the mother position, then you're not going to respect the mother's perspective. So there's that too. But there's also the lack of respect for mothers in the world at the moment. So this is just kind of layers. And so then we don't respect Mother Earth either. So this is what my Indigenous friends talk about. So if the mother is Mother Earth, so this is what the women's wisdom brings. We, and there's even proof in all of these women's spiritual circles, we actually talk, because I've spent a lot of time, this is, how do you put yourself first? I've spent a lot of time in women's circles on how to do that. And so that it's not overtly selfish, but that it's actually for the greater good. It's the other interesting thing to think about. Because, say, my children, they're going to have their own journey, whether they like me or not. They're going to have their own journey. And I'm hoping, like, when I, pass this mortal coil, that they will eventually realize that I've taught them lessons, so that they can come back to themselves. And if that, at the very least, that then they will find their own way. But also, this is where it gets really hectic, where there's been an attack on the family, an attack on the mother. So that's two separate things, COVID, all the world stuff combined. But it's been happening for centuries, and it's been happening since the beginning of modern era, however long it's been going. But we look at Indigenous culture in Australia is matriarchal, and we ream them, don't we? So they respect the mother position because they know mothers hold the seeds for the future, many of them.
Yes. So do you think that understanding that and doing your research, like telling Juliet to research that feminine, what was it?
Feminine therapist theory.
Feminine therapist theory is the first step in really loving yourself. So really, really
If you're a girl or a woman,
anchoring in that knowing and understanding about how important it is to nurture your feminine side, to nurture the fact that you have wants and needs and not be ashamed of those things. Like, even physical needs, we're talking about partnership and sex and intimacy and all of that stuff, like all the stuff that is very in society considered shameful. I think women's sexuality has a lot of shame attached to it, but I also believe that that physical side of ourselves, when we learn how to nurture it and understand it and be accepting of it and loving ourselves through that physical side of ourselves, that it opens up other doors and other avenues in our lives that we, it opens the mind, it opens the spiritual side of ourselves, and it creates a level of happiness that's really deep.
Absolutely. I think even a lot of young people haven't come across these things because the world and the internet and the Internet of Things and even all the information out there, there's a lot of information about pornography. It's a lot of information about what to do to satisfy your man for young women. It's like, hell no. Sorry from my perspective, but but it's like, well, no. What we need to be working on is how do we love ourselves, not as a, just, and dare I go down that route of having a wank or, that kind of thing. It's actually self-love, self-care, knowing your body so that
Yes.
you don't get literally fucked over. Yeah. So it's
Yes.
kind of like, yeah. So, and I'm grateful for some of the things I've experienced in my life. And I've often gone with my intuition around men, my intuition around who's going to look after me, particularly sexually or intimacy-wise. And I haven't usually been wrong.
Yeah.
But a lot of women have lost their balance around that stuff. But
Yeah.
particularly the young women haven't been, the world is so different now that it's like, what would my parents know? But they actually do have some wisdom around this kind of stuff, actually,
Yeah. I
which is
think
interesting. Yeah.
the wisdom, this is an important point too, I think, is the wisdom that we can impart onto our children is still
Yeah.
relevant, even though the world is a different place now. Because it's radically between when my mother was my age and I was Juliet's age, the
Yeah.
comparison of the world changing then and the world changing now, like it's no comparison. Like we've gone through such huge upheaval over the past 3, 4 years,
Yep.
but our wisdom is still relevant. The things that your parents have to say, your generation to your generation, is still relevant. And when I meet, I absolutely love young people. And when I
Yeah, I do.
meet young people, I really feel energized. And I feel like a lot of the young people that I meet are very respectful of me in my age. And we talk about things like they come to me and tell me stuff that they don't tell other people, and they don't even tell their parents because I think they feel safe to actually talk to me about that stuff because I don't have judgment. But I think that it's still relevant what we have to say to young people, and t telling them things like it's okay to be selfish in what's considered to be selfish by, because I believe that society labels things that are selfish that aren't selfish. So
Yes.
I say things like, is it really selfish? Like, really think about it. Think for yourself. Is it really selfish to do something like that? Like, if you want to change your job, or if you want to go and ask for a pay rise, or if you want something more from your relationship with your boyfriend, is it really selfish to want those things? And just by making them think about stuff like that, I think, they don't have the experience in themselves to just naturally think that way. And so by asking them that question, they go, yeah, maybe. Is it really selfish?
Absolutely.
I wanted to talk to this about the young generation because I was going to say it before, and then I think
We
we got
got, yeah.
moved
Yeah,
with it
yeah,
on. So one thing I did really want to say is that in my experience, as much as there is a lot of unbalanced psychology and issues in my generation, it is I really believe that my generation is so filled with awakened souls. Like
yeah.
every
More
and
than ours, I think, yeah.
every place
Yeah.
I go, every single place I go, there is at least one person I meet that is awakened to, and this isn't just to say the spiritual side of awakened, it's also awakened to themselves, awakened to their femininity, or yes, awakened spiritually. Like this is a really big example of you attract the universe is your life is a reflection of yourself, because I'm going to New Zealand next month, and I was asked by a friend who is very spiritual, very embodied, but there's still, I wouldn't say fully awake or anything. But then I said yes, and she was like, "That's amazing. I have another friend coming." And her friend is like a full-on Reiki healer. She learned, I think she's certified in home birthing as a
Wow.
nurse, or And she's my age. She's like just a couple years older. And it's
Wow.
and this is gonna be who I'm traveling New Zealand with. I've never
Yeah, it's
met
going to
her
be a
in my
surprise.
life.
Yeah. Wow.
It's just and I've never even met her, and I'm traveling with her next month for a whole month in New Zealand. And I don't really think that would happen very often in any other I don't know, in any other time in history. So it's just, and anywhere I go, there is at least one person, usually more, that I can have a really good conversation with about spirituality or femininity, or it's so common now. And I think it's becoming just as common as the victimhood side or the mental health. I anything I
Interesting.
find, people my age who are embodied at the moment more than I have on the mental health side. And I understand that it's because you do attract what you are. But if even if we just backtrack to 2, 3 years ago, 4 years ago, victimhood mental health side was kind of everyone I met my age was on that track. But now fast forward, it's just so different. It's so different.
Do you believe they grew out of it?
I think yes. I think also
That's good
as
news.
much as social media is
'Cause that's just 2 years or 3 years we're talking here.
I think as much as social media is a bit of a, I don't know,
Trap.
unhealthy, yeah, a bit of a trap. I think there is really valuable information on there, and there are
Yes,
good people on there
correct.
teaching. There's good therapists on there teaching therapy. There's also spiritual coaches on there too. There's femininity, like there's lessons about femininity and you know, now in our society, in my generation, we do not accept, as women, we accept shit from men a lot less because it's kind of been drilled into us to, you know, expect goddess treatment almost. Like when I go into a relationship, that's what I expect. Now, that being said, I'll also treat him with that same energy, but I, that's
You
what
won't accept less than that.
now I won't accept less than that. And I, as much as I think that would have been the case with or without social media, I also think I see it in a lot of other women too. I also don't see it in a lot of other women, but it at least it's a thing. At least it's
An awareness
an
in
awareness.
women.
Yeah, so I really think that our generation, like I'm meeting 20-year-olds who are 21-year-olds who are so far ahead in life mentally, and I think we're the generation that's gonna grow up the quickest to a, because there's just so much information out there. There's no other way to be in my generation. Like it's just every single day there's new world events, there's new information, there's new things to learn on the internet. And yeah, we're the fastest. I really believe that we're the fastest growing
I
generation.
would agree with that.
So
So I think there's a balance in terms of between the both of those things, like everything. What I've noticed, because I can also talk to my children's generation, and it's not that far from what you're talking about. What I've noticed is an ungrounded spiritual bypassing with some of that information too. So that's the warning I'm giving out to everyone out there. Is you want to be going to a grounded spiritual healer or a grounded spiritual coach or someone who's cut their teeth just because they're a young midwife. This is one of the issues, is they might be okay now, but what if life sets them back? Will they be completely wiped out? So this is what I'm really noticing in some of the young people I'm treating, because I treat young people as well. In therapy, and like just they're great, but there's a lot of ungroundedness. I
I
think you're a
agree with
very
that.
think you're a very grounded person, Juliet, more than you realize. And I think you're giving some people the benefit of the doubt more than they should be giving.
Maybe
I'm
the
just,
people she hangs out with.
yeah, and that's cool. And maybe that's what you're attracting, but I guess what I'm putting out there is a bit of a warning, you know.
Yeah, not everyone's like that.
Be careful, because there are the seriously narcissistic coaches. There are the seriously crazy ass people.
Yeah, and
There are
that's
the
the thing. That's the thing, Renee. If you aren't aware, for whatever reason that is, because you don't want to be aware, because your parents aren't aware, or because your circle has influenced you not to be aware. If you, for whatever reason, are not aware, you can be easily tricked or manipulated into believing someone who is, you believe is a good person and has good intentions. And narcissists believe wholeheartedly that they are good. They don't go around saying, I'm a narcissist, stay away from me.
No.
Their narcissistic tendencies are to bring people in and to have followers and to have, an enclave of people who believe in them and who revere them and who want to put them up on a pedestal and all of that stuff, right? So if you're not aware, if you are easily, looking for something and you want to be attached, you want to belong to something, you could easily fall into the trap of believing somebody who's going to lead you astray. And I think,
Exactly.
yeah, I think that's a very important point that, when part of loving yourself is asking questions, is
Exactly.
Yeah, it is having the benefit of the doubt, is having a brain that's not afraid to say, hang on, I just want to ask a question about that. And you're not blindly following because you think, oh, I'm gonna have these friends, I'm gonna have this community of people around me, I'm gonna, like a lot of religion and churches and stuff like that. Get into the church and then they start to tell you're Christian now, we are the only ones who will be saved, or we're in this religion, we're the only ones who have the right answers, things like that. I think it's important for people to ask questions and to say,
Absolutely.
and to listen to their intuition and develop a healthy distance between, and which is what I tell my kids all the time. Like my son comes home and tells me, oh, so and so told me this story. And then I always say, do you believe it? Do you believe what they said? What's your body telling you about what they're saying? And then bring it back to the body, bring it back to the intuition, bring it back to, because we can be told all sorts of things, we can be shown all sorts of things. We can be led down all sorts of paths, but if we don't have that internal compass and the bravery to ask questions, then that's just blindly following.
Good on you. And I love this kind of conversation that we're having. I love this conversation we're having, that we're, because I think we need to, all of us, no matter what age we are, to be continuously asking questions. And if we don't, we're following along with a cult, or we're following along with, you were referring to religion. We can go down to cult. All of the social media stuff can be cult-like. And I, on purpose, do my social media more spread out, so that that is not what I do, and so that I'm not having blind followers.
Yes, exactly. And you don't want blind followers. You don't want that. You don't, that's not reality. That's something completely different. You want people who are there with their full capacity, understanding why they're there and asking questions and challenging you and, and growing, because challenges grow us. When we are challenged, we grow as humans.
Yep. But on that note, and this is what we talk about in therapy, and I think it, probably your challenges have helped you grow. In some people's cases, challenges don't help them grow. So there's literally the choice point. So this is something about choice, and going back to what Juliet was talking about earlier, was there's the point of choice. Do we choose growth, or do we choose stagnation, or death, or death, or illness? And this is why these conversations are so important, because if we bring it back to the topic at hand, is ourselves. If we look after ourselves, we are more well. But we are more well in the company of others, even having these kind of conversations. So I make it a point to have these kind of conversations with my friends, these kind of conversations with people I know well. We've had all these conversations shut down over the past few years. We were told not to speak to our neighbors. We were told not to do this, not to do that, blah, 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 blah. Well, if you're being told to do something, that's when to question
Ask
it.
why. Ask why.
Well,
And there's so much more suspicion now between people, which you should be asking more questions about too. But do we have to go?
I'm really sorry to cut the conversation
No,
short.
that's all good.
We have to end it somewhere. I think that was a good place to end it.
And Renee, thank you so much. Like, this is every
Thank you.
time we talk to you, it's so
Thank
meaty.
you.
I love it.
Yeah.
You get into it, good.
There's always onion layers.
Okay, well, thank you. I guess we'll see you again soon for another episode. But yeah, I'm sending so much love to everyone. Thank you so much for
Happy New
watching.
Year, everybody.
Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.
Yes. Yeah, and we're sending our love. So,
Bye, everyone.
and
See you
bye,
next week.
Renee.
Bye, Renee. Thank
Bye.
you.
See you. Thank you.